Welcome on the BMR Studio YouTube channel, and today in this episode I will pay you back, guys, something what I really own from a long time, because one of my visitor, Isidoro Mage, he asked from me to do some kind of gear porn video, and this is the best time to do this. So let's go into my home studio and have a look. Sorry if the video will be shaky, or the light conditions are not the best, or maybe the camera will do some really crazy stuff with the autofocusing, but I couldn't find the better way to do a kind of walkthrough and show everything on the different places in my studio. So let's start. This is the place where my friends are sitting and we are watching videos and I don't know. So basically this is nothing fancy, it's just a really simple home cinema system. Under my projector screen, you guys can see this lovely Soundcraft Spirit Studio analog mixer. What I really like, I modified the first 8 channel inside the op-amps and the capacitors and everything, and also I removed the gain stage from the first 8 channel. So this is the analog mixer what I'm using to do a summing bus. So when I press this button now, then all the fader and all the input gain stage is completely switched off, but I still have a possibility to play a beat with the EQs and with the panning. And on this way, I'm telling you guys, this mixer, it's amazing with my digital Tascam mixer. In this corner, you guys can see lot of different boxes, and mostly all is different kind of microphone or measurement system or test system, or this is my video monitor now at the moment. This is my hi-fi and SVJS video corner. I really like this video recorder, and nothing fancy, it's just a Kenwood KRF 970D amplifier. Here is nothing, it's just a tape recorder and a tape player, and this is one of my CD player. Here you can see more CD player from Denon, from Pioneer, and time to time I just replace them if I want to get a different listening experiment. Chocolate! I cannot live without chocolate. Next to my guest room, here where we builded this small mic booth, let's say like this. This line, I think I did one time a video about this lovely Art DRX processor. And so this is my Art Host channel, this is my vocalist effect processor just for the vocalist. And this is my headphone amplifier, and on the top again lot of microphones, microphone, headphone, microphone, preamplifier. So at the moment I have at least if I remember good, like 20 different purpose of microphone. That's all about my mic booth. Here is the digital cables, here is again digital cables. This is again cables, and here more cables, and here more cables, and here more cables. From cables, you never can have enough. How it's called? Evolution U-Control U33. And I builded a kind of pulled under it to hold also this Döpfer pocket feeder. By the way, this is the setup what I used in the past to do a live act shows, and these two guys together, it's a really nice setup to do a live X. So A channel, master fader, lot of ports, blah blah blah, faders, programmable buttons, whatever. Nowadays, this is the system what I'm using to program the Yamaha AN1X. The scenes I told you guys, this is my virtual analog corner, so Yamaha AN1X. If you want to get a really nice videos about Yamaha AN1X, go to the JB's channel. He has a lot of excellent videos with Yamaha AN1X, and he's also doing a lot of really nice patches for the synthesizer. I really like this synthesizer. My next synth, I fall in love when this synth came to the market, but in that time I don't have this amount of money to buy it. This is the Novation Supernova 2. I expanded to 36 voice at the moment, but my target is the 48 voice. This synthesizer is the haven of potmeters and controllers and buttons and displays and whatever. Look how beautiful it is. And it's really laid out really well, so really clean layout. Oscillators, filters, LFOs, inputs, whatever, envelopes, the multi-trimball controls, and effects and level. And wow, I really like this synthesizer. In when I was young and this synthesizer came to the market, I fall in love because I tried it in one of my friend's studio in Hungary, and I'm telling you guys, I almost cried after it to get one time this synthesizer. By the way, now the Virus has the TI-2, which is much more powerful and sophisticated than the Virus KC, but somehow the KC has a really unique kind of sound because of the limits of the DSP power inside. And this synth, again, it's a kind of heaven on controls and potmeters. So again, very well layout. So LFOs, oscillators, mixer, effects and filters, and beautiful. This synth is really, really beautiful. I bought this on eBay for almost nothing, let me tell you, and let you cry also, because this synth is seated in a studio where the studio gets some kind of huge water issue and leakages, I don't know, or some sewage pipe is broken, and this synth get full water inside. So all the synth inside and all the case and the cabinet, everything is damaged and rusted and whatever. So I fixed one by one all the parts. Maybe here you can see this part here, it's a bit other color than this one, and of course the bottom is with the same. So I repainted the full synth, and I made with my hands a new side panel from garbage wood, and of course I repaired all the electronic, all the damaged electronics inside. And this is I think I did this 3 years ago or something like this, and I really enjoyed to repair this scene because I bought this scene for nothing, for almost nothing, because nobody wanted to buy it with this description. It has a sewage water inside, so you can imagine what kind of dirt and shit was inside. Sirius from the Quasimidi. It's kind of virtual analog with sample-drived voices, or I don't know, it's using some kind of weird synthesis engine, but it also has a really unique characteristic, and JB also have a really nice sound set for that on his website. So thank you, JB, for the sound sets. And by the way, I really like this synth to do vocoder stuff. Maybe you can see here, this is the original microphone for it. This I bought I think about 150 euro or something like this in a broken. In the past, I always want one synth like this from the Sirius, and I really like the way how they laid out and how they are handling the multi-trimbal functions. For example, here you can see this is your kick drum channel, this is your snare drum channel, this is your hi-hat, other percussions, and you have three synthesizer, and this is your vocoder, so you can mute, select, pan, effect, whatever. It's a really, this synth is about live act in a really quick way on a stage. So this Sirius can be your main synthesizer in your live act section, because who cares about analog voices on a live act gig? So thumbs up for this synth. This is a really great German synthesizer. It's nothing, it's just about insert effects to my mixer. So I have here a patch bay, of course. Under that I have this Lexicon MX400. I really like this effect unit because it has two stereo input, and with that I can use this one unit to do four effects in the same time on a mono or double stereo. And of course this is not this top-notch Lexicon PCM96 or something like this, but I'm telling you guys, for a home studio you need at least one MX400 to do some kind of outside reverb or other kind of effects. It has a lot of built-in effects and a lot of parameters, and it also has a really nice sound, and it's clean and whatever. So I really like it. The next one is the VoiceWorks Plus from TC Helicon. I use this effect mainly on vocal channels. Let me tell you, this effect unit is also working really well with all the analog synthesizers, because this you can use to generate more harmonics in any kind of really basic analog sound, and is give a really freaking complex and unique sound for your old analog synthesizer. So this is why I use this patch panel to patch here my synthesizer and patch only the VoiceWorks Plus and feed it back to my mixer. The next effect unit what I have here is the TC Electronic D2 with a lot of really lovely multi-tap delay function. And by the way, if you believe or not, I just using for this kind of delay, which is emulation of the 2290 from the TC Electronic, which is the legend of all delays. And this D2, it's cost like 200 or 300 euro or something like this. But if you want to buy 2290 delay from the TC Electronic, you have to pay about 1,500 euro, which is insane in a home studio. So this is Pureman 2290. This is a Yamaha SPX2000. I'm telling you guys, this is one of the best reverb what I ever heard in my life. Of course, minus the big TC6000 series or something like this, but this SPX2000 from the Yamaha, it sounds amazing, it's act amazing, it's a really unique and wow, I really like it. Kind of high-end gear, of course, with 96K sampling rate, with all the digital input, output, blah, 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 MIDI controllable. And it has a really nice remote controller software, so you can adjust the parameter of the room and blah, 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 a lot of hided stuffs inside, and I really like it. The next one is not an effect, but it's an effect. It's a Yamaha CS6R synthesizer. I think it's one of the most unique sounding synthesizer from the Yamaha, and I really like this synthesizer because you can store here your own patches. There is drum patches, there is built-in patches, and more patch everywhere. But what you can do with that, it has also a software in the Yamaha Studio software system, where you can adjust every freaking parameter, and you can move and delay and modulate the tones, which is in the voices, which has kind of weird mixing engine. And so on the end, if you wanna get a really busy and heavy lush sounds and kind of digital sample based sounds, this is the right synth for that, because this synth is really underrated, so the prices are not so high. It's just 100 euro or 200 euro. And you also can install inside different kind of Yamaha sound panel. And you also can install into this a full Yamaha AN1X with a PLG AN board. So yeah, it's a really nice rack synth. And why is it here in the effect section? Because this synth you can use also as a effect, because it has two line input. Here you can see this is one, this is two. So I can patch here the input, and on the back I can get only the effect engine, which contain a really nice digital EQ filter with very nice resonance and whatever. So this is again a good tool if you have old synthesizer without any kind of effects, and this Rex synth you can use as a really sophisticated and high quality effect in your synth. This is some kind of no-name speaker. I replaced the driver inside to the coaxial speaker from Morel, and now is a really linear kind of speaker, but it's a small diameter speaker and really natural and really flat frequency characteristic. Maybe you can see from here this Morel driver. The next one is the Yamaha how they called HS 5 or 6, if I remember. I think it's a H 5, I don't know. It's a bang for a buck. So the linearity and how it can handle the high dynamics, and let me tell you, this small speaker, it can produce unbelievable amount of bass sound in this small cabinet. And I think they try to copy their own NS10 kind of flat frequency characteristic, but of course there is a difference between this and between the real NS10. And yeah, actually I really like it. Most of the case I use this for the first mixing, for really just normal purpose monitoring. Of course, then when the starting the mastering and all the fine adjustment, the progress, I've used the Yamaha S10X. And what is the X mean? The X is the latest one from the Yamaha S10, and the X is give you a shielded magnetic drivers in the cabinet. So what does it mean if you have CRT monitor or CRT TV or whatever, this speaker will not bother your system. And the Yamaha fixed the issue with the tweeter in the X series, because you know guys, the all the NS10 monitor speaker have some kind of issue with the high frequency with the tweeter, and a lot of engineers, they placed a paper tissue here on the front of the tweeter to corrigate this error. Actually, you can find the articles about it, like just type into the Google tissue issue. This is how the engineers call this high frequency issue with the normal Yamaha NS10 monitor. So this is the X, and the really nice story about this speaker. After 6 years of hunting, I find this speaker next to my house. So he's one of my neighborhood. And when I get the address from him, from the eBay to go and pick up, I just laugh on it. It cannot be. He's my next neighborhood. And I just have to drive, just walk 20 meter. And he gave me this speaker with all the original box, original packing, original user manual, original grill, everything. So in my other storage, I have everything from this monitor in an original state. It's unbelievable how lucky I am with this monitor speaker. Nowadays on a market, if you wanna buy a really sophisticated mixer for your money, this is one of the best choice. Why? Because a lot of the studios, a lot of FOG mixers and everybody, now they are selling this Tasca mixer for almost nothing. About it's running now about 2,000 or 3,000 euro. This is a really normal price for it. In the past, this has cost a hell of a lot of money. And of course, this mixer have a hell of a lot of function. And so let me explain to you why I like this mixer. First of all, the inputs, all the inputs, what you can see here, it's analog gain stated channels. So it's not this digital rubbish. So here you have a real analog gain settings, and here you can switch by hand. It will be line or minus 20 dB or microphone, normal microphone level, and you can switch on and off by hand the phantom power. The next one, why I really like it, this huge meter unit with timecode display on it, and this is a really nice touch on this mixer. By the way, the DM 3200 and the DM4800, it's almost the same mixer, just the smaller brother has of course less channels on the front of you, but beyond that everything is the same. Let me continue this really small review on this mixer, why I choose this mixer. It has switchable two different monitor output, which mean if you don't have monitor controller here in this section, you can do it. The next one, it has two phone output, and the whole digital control section is laid out excellent. And I'm telling you guys, it's so easy to do a bus switching, output assigning, to do a direct monitoring, stereo, blah blah blah. This is your dynamic section, this is your parametric EQ section, this is your aux sending section. So by the way, this is the channel strip, let's say like this, and the EQ, it's kind of digital Tascam sound EQ, but if you don't care the EQ, so if you have a EQ, nice EQ channel strip into in your DAW system, of course you can eliminate this EQ, but the dynamic section, the gate and the compressor and the expander are fantastic how it's working. Kind of digital sound, but it's really, really precise. The screen, it's a kind of awful because it's just two color and really small, and it has some kind of old LCD issue with contrast and blah blah blah. But all the rest, everything, it's really well laid out. And let me show you something really important in the mixing world. If you cannot do this, okay? If you cannot do this on your mixer, it's meaning your mixer is not good for mixing. This mixer, of course, because it's motorized faders, you can use this mixer as, sorry, so you can use this mixer as a MIDI remote controller, and then all this surface and all this controllers, it came to your biggest MIDI controller into your DAW system. It's a kind of hassle to do all the setup for the MIDI controlling, but with the MIDI controlling you get also a jog control, which is a really nice jog control here, and you also get play, stop, record, forward function and all other automation functions, and it has a lot of input channels and a lot of output channels. Many auxes, I don't know, look how many, 64 channel you can mix just in this mixer, and you have 24 bus, you have 12 aux bus, and it's really good mixer for a home recording. I think this is kind of overshoot for a home recording, but look, the length of the faders is not this 5 or 6 centimeter rubbish. This is a real 12 centimeter motorized faders, and it's react really quickly, and if you touch it, it's also touch sensible. So yeah, this is a really great mixer. Many things, but the biggest big deal about this mixer, you cannot find nowadays one mixer on a market for a reasonable good price which has 24 input channel and is running on 96k with 24 bit sampling. All the other digital mixers nowadays, somehow, some while, they just using or less channel, physical channel, or with lower sampling rate, with this rubbish 48k. With this mixer you don't have this issue, because it can run on a 96k, 24 bit, with 24 analog input channel. Of course, on the back of this mixer, I will show you guys what kind of weird lot of channels and connectors you have. This mixer, for this price, it's unbelievable and unbeatable. I don't know why the Tascam is stopped to produce this mixer, but let me tell you, this is my old dream to get this mixer to here and use as a MIDI controller and the real mixer. Another feature what I really like about this mixer, here you can see, you have a lot of space under it to mark everything what is what, and you also have here a place where you can place your masking tape and write on it the things. And this, let me tell you, the distance and the resting for your palm is in the best position what I ever seen in this price level of mixer. So I don't want to speak more about my mixer, but I really like it. Of course I will go to the back and I will show you everything from the back. Yeah, I have here I have here a Behringer stuff. Every home studio have a Behringer stuff. What is this? This is actually a Ultra Curve Pro, and I use this unit only for do a level checking. So it has RTA, you can install measurement microphone, so you can see exactly in your studio what's going on with the frequencies. Of course, you can see what's going on with the frequencies in your music with the really nice dB measurement and blah, blah, blah. This is only a purpose why I keep this here, so I'm not using any kind of processing from that. It's really just passively attached to my main master bus, and this is only the purpose why I use it. Of course, I find that somehow the auto EQ is working really well on techno sounds. So you can use this easily in your home recording system to do kind of master EQing on your techno sounds. On acoustics sounds, I find, yeah, it's not a highest quality of effect processor. My next lovely gear is the DBX Quantum 2. I cannot live without that. This is my main mastering processor. Of course, in the past I have money analog gears, analog EQs and compressors and whatever, but let me tell you guys, this Quantum 2, it can do for me all the jobs on a mastering what I have to do here in my home studio. Of course, I'm not a mastering studio at all, and this is only a tool what I'm using to do a really final touches on my mixes. And by the way, this is a tool what I use for do a quick mastering on my songs. My converter is also this DBX Quantum 2, because the mixer main output, analog output, is not the highest quality on the planet, but from that mixer I can send here 96k 24-bit digital sound to this DBX Quantum 2, and time to time I just use this to convert this digital to the analog, and because this is real DBX unique, I'm telling you guys, the converter inside and the last op-amp stage, it's amazing, clean and really nice. I cannot speak about more like this. I did already, I think, 4 video or 3 video about this unit, and I really like it. My next one is my master recorder, which is working on CD or on HDD. And why I like this unit, because this unit also contain a dynamic processor, which is working on the, not inline, it's working only on a recorded sound. So what is mean? It's working slowly on your song, on a final compression, but it's do excellent work on this kind of dynamic processing. And of course, because this is a master grade CD recorder from the LSEs, of course this is give me a completely 100% Red Book compatible CD on a output. So I recorded to HDD, I can do here a normal slice and cuts, and eliminate final dynamic issues, and then I can write out to the CD with CD text information and a lot of stuff. And of course, this also can run on digital domain fully, so it's compatible with 96K 24 bits, so I can send the data from my mixer exactly just to here, to this master recorder. And from that, I'm telling you guys, this also have a really nice converter, so most of the time I use only this one with my mixer, and this is what I drive to my first input of my monitor controller, and it's doing a really nice job, and it's a clean, noiseless solution to listen back your songs from the digital domain. The next gear here is, this is my normal daily using monitor controller from the Behringer. Nothing fancy, it's running around 150 euro or something like this, but as you can see here, you get a lot of possibilities to connect a lot of sources. You can connect a lot of monitor speaker, even you can connect balanced or unbalanced input on outputs also. There is a parallel monitoring input, and this is my best friend on this monitor controller, because you can attach here a USB, and then you can hook up other computer to see, for example, the frequency responses and do some really basic measurement on your incoming signal. This monitor controller is absolutely not passive and the most cleanest monitor controller, but for kind of general purpose for home recording studios, for home monitoring, it's far away okay. And then of course for monitoring I have different headphones from Beyer Dynamic, from Sennheiser, and I have other from Beyer Dynamic. Of course this also, it's always upgraded. Almost every half year I buy a new headphone or a pair of headphone, and what I used here for a monitoring is going to my mic booth, and the new always coming here. At the moment this is my favorite headphone. This is the Beyer Dynamic DT880. I really like this headphone. This field recorder I just use for record my dialogues and all the everything which is happening here in the studio, if I doing for you guys a video. And yeah, so this is only for that. What I like about this Tascam field recorder, it's small, but it's a really massive built-in, and it has four input channel plus other kind of normal stereo input, so I can do with that let's say kind of sophisticated mix and record parallelly with my camera and with my system and with my computer, and then on the video editing I can mix them together. Basically this field recorder is almost always sitting here, minus if I'm using for outside for real field recording. So the next gear here in my gear porn video is this lovely old Teak X1000 tape recorder. Actually this is not a really professional tape recorder, but the story of this tape recorder, we did some kind of work in one of my friend's house. So then on the end of the work he showed me this unit in his basement, and actually it's full with garbage and with moisture and with insects and spiders and spider webs. So I even cannot recognize this tape recorder, how was the original name and whatever. So then I started to renovate it, and looks now it's absolutely in a gorgeous condition, inside and outside. So I repaired every part, and I replaced a lot of bearing and belt system and motor and some kind of motor controller, and also I upgraded a bit all the signal processing inside in this unit, but I kept the original tape signal processing, which is fully analog. So what this tape recorder can do for me, these tape recorders, all these X1000 or the X2000 series, including the M, which is the master tape recorder, they contain a kind of tape EQing circuit, which give a bit more soft and more live kind of bass and highs on a tape. Also, you know guys, the tapes has a really nice saturation on a frequency ranges, and also as you can see here, this tape recorder is not driven with this Dolby BC blah blah blah. It's driven with the DBX noise reduction system, which is also gives some kind of really nice and soft compression and expansion on your records. So actually, when I record from this master CD player cross some small cable to this tape recorder and I'm listening back, if you believe or not, this it sounds much more better than I listen only the CD. So I cannot explain to you more about it, but on a numbers, of course the CD is much more wider dynamic range than the tape, but the tape give something to the music which is, it's like bang, this is what you need. So most of the time I'm use this recorder to on my hip-hop music because of this really sophisticated bass responses and because of this soft compression. Next item, I think I already did for you guys a video about this. This is my MV8800 music production studio. I use this as a drum machine for my hip-hop songs and also for do a synchronization, because this Roland MV8800 has a really tight and really precise MIDI time code and everything inside. It's a really nice sounding analog constant cue graphical EQ. It's made by the BSS and the name is FCS 966. I really like this unit because it sounds really transparent and natural, and if I do here a really slight modification on a high end, I cannot hear any kind of hiss which is coming from this unit. And if you find this on eBay, it's running around 150-160 euro or something like this, or even on 200. Don't think of it. This is one of the best graphical EQ on a second-hand market what you can get for a reasonable price. And as you can see here, it has a lot of other functions. Sooner or later, this device also will replace it with one of my new development. Under it, I have a synth, which is from the EMU E4X series. This is the Hollywood Gold synthesizer. This is actually a most rare synthesizer from the EMU, because from this Hollywood Gold, they not produced too much. And I absolutely really like how this synth is generating the sound and how the effects are working. I absolutely love, fall in love of the filtering and the resonance of this synthesizer. With this synthesizer I can produce a really massive and complex sounds, which is based of course on samples, but the samples I can update because it's contain HDD and a lot of memory, and also I can place inside the EMU sound ROMs. So you can imagine I have now on that around 24,000 different samples, and from that huge sample library I can do a lot of really heavy and massive sounds. I'm not using all the time this synth, but when I need something really complex, real synthesizer kind of sound, this is one unit what I'm using together with my Yamaha CS6R. And of course, because this is the version of the Hollywood Gold, it contains all the goodnesses from the EMU system. So under that, I have a couple of pieces from this Alesis RA150 amplifier, as you see with all the original user manual and with the guarantee papers and everything. Why I like those amplifiers? Now I just have here two pieces, but from that I have altogether four pieces. So why I like these amplifiers? If you believe or not, this is really bang for the bucks. I don't want to say there is no better amplifier than this, but this 150, it's far away enough to drive Yamaha NS10 monitor speakers. I find inside in these amplifiers a really nice design, how they are working. Soon, of course, I will come with some video, explain to you guys why this LSE's Era 150 amp is one of the best choice on the market, even on new or even on second. And I think the new ones, they are running around 200-300 euro, if I remember good. But on second hand, you cannot believe, you can find these amplifiers around 80-90 euro. So this is really bang for the bucks. So if you are looking for some kind of really precise and really good amplifiers. So from here we jump to my old synth corner. The first synth, of course, this is a Yamaha DX7 Mark II D. I really like this synthesizer, mostly because the keys, I'm telling you guys, this is one of the best synthesizer kind and type of key what you can find on a new market or on a second-hand market. And of course, this is a really beast of a machine. If you get familiar with how to program it and how to change the sound and the patches and the envelopes and everything, then it's really a great synth under your hand. Of course, I bought this on eBay for almost nothing, really for almost nothing. I just paid for that couple of euros, but even I not reached the 10 euro, because of course it has some kind of issue. I fixed it, and then I find this synthesizer, it sounds really unique and powerful. And what you guess, what I find inside in a signal path. Of course, this synthesizer is using some kind of DBX technology from this age, when those tape recorders are made. So the last expander and the dynamic processor is DBX. So yeah, it's a bit hissy and noisy, but I'm telling you guys, when you double the tone, so you do like dual voice mode, and you tap more than 10 keys together, or you drive with MIDI, you cannot believe what kind of deep synthesized FM kind of tones can be come out from this synthesizer. So I really like it, and this is a really beast. I think you cannot live without Yamaha DX7, if you ask me. This is the Casio CZ1 synthesizer, and yeah, nothing fancy. It's a really other great synthesizer if you want to do some kind of space kind of noises, or you want to do a real deep bass. This is the best synth for that, because the CZ1, it has aftertouch and modulation and blah blah blah. So this is one of the most advanced synthesizer from the CZ lines, and I really like it. Yeah, this is an animal. This is the Roland GD800. Oh guys, it's again a heaven of heaven of controllers and potmeters and modification and everything. I think a couple of years ago, like 5-10 years ago, this synth is runner for almost nothing, because it's really underrated synth in a pan. So this is the time when I bought it. Of course, I did a full renovation on that, so I cleaned all the parts, all the keys and all the buttons and all the potmeters and everything. So now this is a real beast, and I really like it. Most of the case, I use this for carpet kind of sounds, and this lushy synthesized sounds. It's, I think, if you ask me, the I much more like the sound of the GD800 than, for example, the D50 from the Roland. Both of them are using almost the same synthesis technology, but somehow the GD800 has much more massive possibilities, and somehow the sound is much more unique. And yeah, this is a real big beast in my studio. I absolutely like it. The next one is, this is only one of real analog synthesizer in my studio. This is the Roland Super GX or GX10, if you know that. This actually two pieces of GP8 synthesizer in one case, and fully analog. I don't know. I think I will do a video on this synthesizer. So again, this is two synth in one case with a massive amount of voice capability. And I'm telling you guys, if you use this synth from here up to here, you're really happy with the sounds, what is can come out from this synthesizer. Absolutely beast, absolutely analog. Now I just hunting for a controller surface, because you can place here to this area a PG800 programmer. The next one here, this is my Digitech IPB10 pedal board. I'm not a guitarist, so I cannot play on a guitar like a good guitarist. I just started now in 1 or 2 years ago to play on a guitar, and I like this pedal system, because here I can place my old Apple iPod, and then I can choose different configuration. I can replace compressors, EQs, phaser, whatever, modulator, blah blah blah, delay. It has a massive amount of DSP processing inside, and it also have a lot of inputs and outputs and MIDI, IO, and blah blah blah. So yeah, I really like this pedal board. The sound, I'm not fully happy with the sound of this pedal, mainly because I think they did a good job on converters, but somehow I can hear it's really DSP driven pedal system, so it's not this fully analogish old kind of guitar tone what it can come out from that. But of course, for training and for use as a hobby pedal, this is one of the best choice I think on a market. Yeah, it's I think it's a good choice, and I think it's a bit overkill for a guitar training. Next to it, this is a really old amplifier from Kenwood, when the Kenwood is called Trio. So I think this is the time when the Kenwood is changed from Trio to simple Kenwood. So this amplifier I got from one of my friend. He find it in some old house, or I don't know. And up to now, this is actually the amp what I used to drive my small 5-inch monitors, which is upgraded with more air speakers. It's absolutely noiseless, and I really like it. Not a big power guy, so it's around 25 watt or something like this, but what a nice sound can you get from it. And listen, this all these potmeters, it's yeah. So I don't know nowadays why nobody is doing like this, and everything is rotary switches and beautiful. This is a fully analog Russian synthesizer. I used this in the past, in the 80s and in the 90s, for my hip-hop songs, and it's just sitting here from more than 10 years, something like this. In this last 10 years, I didn't use it at all, because I have many other synths, of course, but sooner or later I will show you guys what is inside. Don't think this is something really big, heavy Sputnik synthesizer or something. This is a really basic synthesizer, but on some settings it give a really unique hip-hop carpet kind of sound. So yeah, this is my guitar. Of course, this is a Fender Stratocaster, but this is original USA Stratocaster. So this is a really nice condition Fender Stratocaster. I bought this in Hungary. Old owner, he gets some kind of bankruptcy, so he want to pay out his bills in December when the Christmas is came. So I paid for this guy a reasonable good price for this guitar, but far away not what is the value of this guitar. So you can see there is some kind of luck is went out, but I absolutely like this guitar and absolutely fall in love to this guitar. It's used, it has its ages, so I don't want to replace the bands or whatever. So yeah, and it's absolutely original Fender Stratocaster from the USA, and it's a really old one. And yeah, I absolutely like this guitar. This is only one of the guitar what I'm using now, but of course now I started to hunting more guitars, acoustic guitars, bass guitars and whatever. But yeah, it's a really beast. The strings on it, now I just tried. I tried different strings. Maybe here you can see I have a different strings and string sets. But now I'm telling you guys, I hooked up with Fender Ballet strings, and now this give me a best feeling on a play. So it's really easy to bend, it's really easy to tap to the band, and this sounds absolutely amazing. Cables everywhere, cable, lot of cable and cable and more cable and more cable and more cable and more cable. This is my one of my MIDI interface. This is Alessium AL88C. I think you saw already my video about this system. I really like it. This is actually not a studio subwoofer, but of course I replaced the woofer and I did some kind of modification in a box. I paid for that, I think 7 or 10 euro. My favorite brand on the cables, it's of course Cordial. I find the Cordial is give you a really nice sounding for the price. So almost every cable here what I have, it's Cordial. So back to my mixer again. Look how many inputs and outputs you can get with the Tascam DM mixer. This is all the inputs here, okay? Then I have here additional input, and this is my FireWire interface card. This mixer also have 1, 2, 3 TDIF interface and ADAT interface, other MIDI interface, a serial port, GPIO port. You can attach to it a foot switch, and here you have all of your aux sends and returns. So send and return, it's 8 send and return, and everything is balanced. So this is not this unbalanced rubbish. And then this is your monitoring section. So you have 1, 2, 3 monitor output plus other unbalanced. It's just for listening back normal music on your studio if you tired out from the music. But again, time code word synchronization, input, output, digital I/O, digital I/O, SPDF I/O, and USB interface, and blah, blah, blah. So this mixer, and I have here still one port, which is not used, because if you use the FireWire interface with 32 channel in, out, then the system is asking to remove this plate here. But if I'm not using the FireWire, again, I can hook up other additional 16 input and 16 output, and inside in this mixer, you cannot imagine what kind of routing you can do. So how you can handle the auxes, the sends, the buses, and everything. This is I'm telling you guys, this is a real beast of a machine for the price. And this is my master keyboard when I do a songwriting here in front of my computer. Let me tell you how good is the Novation Supernova. This is how not good this master keyboard. I think I will do some kind of review video on that master keyboard. If you find this on eBay for half or quarter price, it's okay, you can jump on it, because maybe a lot of you guys have more softwares and more computer based songwriting or music creation, and for that this master keyboard, it's really okay. There is a tons of controls, rotary controls, normal pot meters, drum pads, more pot meters, programmable keys, whatever. But in my case, in this crazy setup, when I have a lot of outboard synths and gears, this is really not friendly, because I still have a hassle with the software on the computer and blah 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 blah, and I'm not really like the hustlers. This one, it's really cheap. On new, it's like 35 euro or something like this. This is the Shuttle Express controller. Many, these are used only for controlling the Adobe Premiere for the video cutting, but it's also good for any kind of those system. And of course, you can program it, the buttons, what which button is doing what. My configuration is really simple. This is delete, this is undo, this is redo, and this is select, and so really basic functions. Next to it, I think this is a really nice trackball system from the Kenningston. I think this is one of the best from them. Look how it's absolutely fit under my heavy, big, massive palm. So yeah, I really like it. It's absolutely top-notch trackball. And last but not least, this is my camera setup that I'm using for create YouTube videos for you guys. And nothing fancy, is just really basic. So I have a field monitor, I have a couple of different light sources, but I have this Sony on-camera light. It's a really good product if you're looking for original Sony lamp for your camera. And this is a Sony PXW-X70 camera. I really like this camera because it's a really professional camera in a really small body. And what is mean, this camera can record 10-bit, many professional functions, and really nice image stabilization what is have inside, and also can record 4K videos without any problem. The stand is some kind of Manfrotto stand from the Pro line, I think, and the head is this Manfrotto 504 HD. I really like this head. And last, this is my workstation computer. This is the HP 840Z workstation with really fully filled up with double CPU, with lot of memory, HDDs, SSDs, other HDDs, I don't know. And I also have inside a really nice video card and also this Blackmagic Decklink 4K I/O card to do a monitoring or 4K recording from my old analog systems. I have a couple of other stuffs outside and everywhere in all of my storages. For example, this we find in one of the basement, but we have to clean it and make it empty. Actually is full with dust and with dead animals even. So what is this actually? This is some kind of German orgel. This is how they call it. Every register has its own oscillator here and also on the bottom. And maybe here you can see how many cables and analog cables are running to the bottom part where is also have the bass pedal. So this will be a really interesting project to repair it or get something out from this orgel. And look how this is really a garbage. So I don't know, this will be I think this will be a very nice organ in my studio. And this is also some kind of gear porn, because if you guys dealing with computers or with music or editing videos or just simply gaming on your computer, don't forget your body to to take care of your body. Yes, we arrived to the end of this gear porn video on my YouTube channel. Thank you very much, Isidore Mage, to ask from me to shoot this. I really enjoyed it. I hope you guys also enjoyed this video. So if you have any kind of question about one of my gear or you want to see teardown video, just leave your comment here on our YouTube channel and I will reply it, or I will shoot a new video. And in the closest future I will share with you guys something really interesting, because I started to develop a product for exactly for home recording studios and also for higher class professional studios. So stay tuned, a lot of interesting stuff will come. So catch you next time. Bye.